Hello, my name is Karine Vermeulen. I work at WAAG, an institute for technology and society in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. And I'm head of program of WAAG's Learn team. Today, I will take you on a journey in the world of maker education. And I will do that based on a presentation. So you don't see me, but you can Google me, of course. But I promise I have great slides and some videos, and I think it will be worthwhile. Thank you in advance for joining me, and I wish you a fruitful session. WAAG is proud partner in the Horizon 2020 Do It project. Do It is all about entrepreneurial skills for young social innovators in an open digital world. But basically, Do It consists of three pillars: maker education, social innovation, and entrepreneurial competences. In the Do It project, educational programs have been designed and tested in which children and youth learn to use digital tools and technologies by following social innovation principles to develop their entrepreneurial competences. And in this presentation, I will share my experiences. I will explain what maker education is, where it comes from, and why I believe it's so important. Maker education, or learning by making, and the creative use of new technologies in designing and making solutions for real-world problems, has proven to be very engaging and effective in a way to help children and youngsters develop their creative and entrepreneurial mindset and skills. As an example, I would like to start to tell you a story, the story of Ismael. Ismael first came to our new makerspace in the public library in Amsterdam. Within 1 hour, he invented his flying house for the future. A flying house that let him escape his crowded house and neighborhood from time to time and helped him easily navigate through the world and city that he didn't know yet. So what he did, is it a new idea? Is it the best idea? I don't know, probably not. But what matters is that it was new to him and it made make him think about his life, his neighborhood and his future. And it very quickly let him prototype his ideas into a tangible object that helped him express his ideas and talk about it with his parents. And his parents had no idea that Ismael sometimes was fed up with his little brothers and sisters, and that he was very curious to discover the city. And I think that experience, that learning experience, is very valuable for him, but also for his parents. At WAAG, we have a lot of experience in the field of maker education. In this session, I will tell you about it and hopefully inspire you to dive deeper into the matter and start experimenting yourself. First of all, let me briefly tell you something about WAAG and our context, because it determines my view on learning and education and the role of technology in society. WAAG is a cultural institution founded in 1995. Its mission is to research the role of technology in society and to democratize it, to make sure we as people can use it, understand it, to shape our lives and give meaning to our living environments, to make technology open, more fair and inclusive. In our vision, technology is culture. It is made by people, it is made by us. And technology is not neutral. That means that we need to have a critical stance towards technological developments. Not pessimistic, but critical. We need to develop skills and competences to reflect on how technology is being designed, is being made, and to the way it influences our daily lives. Preferably starting at a very young age. Before we dive into the how of things, maybe first zoom out a little bit and dwell on the why. So, what's going on? Why is there a need for young European social innovators with entrepreneurial skills and mindsets? And why is there a need for innovation in education? We all know we live in challenging times. We are facing big problems we don't know the answers to. More specifically, I would like to focus on two issues: the issue of sustainability and of rapid technological developments. So back in the days before the Industrial Revolution, when there were guilds, economy was based on the close combination of knowledge and skills. Industrialization brought us enormous prosperity, but at the same time created a separated knowledge economy and a maker industry. And it resulted in decentralized, closed and non-transparent production systems. It resulted in models of mass production and consumption, in which we produce things on the one end of the world and ship it for consumption to the other end. We created enormous cities that import massive amounts of goods, things, stuffs, food, etc., and we export unimaginable quantities of waste. And in doing so, we created an enormous footprint. The so-called hidden impact of things is incredibly damaging to our planet. As you can see in this image by the Dutch Barbette Porcelain, the largest impact comes not from meat or transportation, but from consumer products that we ship all over the world. We should start producing only what we need in a more sustainable way. At the same time, our world is saturated by technology and smart applications, offering lots of opportunities to make a better world. But technology is also increasing inequality, and it's becoming more and more difficult for millions of people to find a safe and just place in the world. And there are flaws in our smart cities, because solutions often start with technology instead of human and urban challenges. In our big smart cities, where technology is top-down being implemented, often there's little or no role for citizens. We need to be careful we don't become a victim of our systems, and we need to take agency. We need to become smart citizens. Citizens that harness the power of technology and that refuse to be consumers, clients, and informants only, but reclaim agency towards the processes, algorithms, and systems that shape our world. We need to gain agency, and in order to do that, we need different skills. As you can see, for instance, creativity will be very important because, and you probably have heard this before, we don't know what our world and jobs in the future will look like. And therefore, we also need to develop the capacity to learn. We need to be flexible and to self-direct our learning and to adapt to a rapidly changing world, to learn new skills and to learn how to use these new technologies to shape our own life and living environment. And yet, often we as adults, especially in education, pretend to know it all. But in fact, we really don't. We should engage children on an early age in the challenges of our times and take them and their ideas seriously. It's an old quote by Sir Ken Robinson, but sadly, often still true. So there's an urgent need to change and to innovate education. He says we don't grow into creativity, we grow out of it, or rather, we get educated out of it. Fortunately, there's a lot of opportunities to do better. And in my opinion, the maker movement offers an interesting and promising approach. At WAAG, for over 10 years, we host a Fab Lab. For those of you who don't know, a Fab Lab is a physical space with machines that allow personal digital fabrication. It's a concept by Neil Gershenfield of the MIT, and the idea is to have a new makerspace with accessible and relatively low-cost technology in which you can make almost anything. Fab Labs are not only creative physical and technical places, they are connected worldwide. Everything that is being made in a Fab Lab is being documented and shared online, and therefore together they also form sort of a knowledge network. All these modern open technologies enable us to combine knowledge, creative skills, passion and purpose again. And there's an opportunity to connect knowledge economy and maker industry. And even to take it a step further, communities that are both producers and end users. In doing so, potentially, we would not be transporting things or goods around the world, but data. And we would reduce our footprint. Very early on, we noticed that in our Fab Lab, interesting learning is taking place. Learning that is intrinsically motivated, interdisciplinary, intergenerational, and often project or practice based. These are interesting principles to apply to education. And since then, we have been hosting a lot of educational programs in our Fab Lab, from Fab Academy to Fab School workshops for children. Maker education builds upon the principles of the maker movement, and it brings together creativity and technology. Maker education addresses heads, hearts, and hands of children. And as an example, I would like to show you the video of Esteban. I think there are some really important lessons in what Esteban says and what he represents. To start with, he says, fantasy is the key to creativity. And he starts with something that he really loves. And in doing so, he learns a lot. His big dream and ambition to contribute to his community sort of naturally follow his skills and competences, since his world is bigger and opened up. And I think it's fantastic, don't you? For me, Esteban represents the so-called maker mindset. I personally really like this visualization by John Spencer. For us, maker education is about a maker mindset and maker skills. It is not so much aimed at mastering machines or new technologies, but more about the realization that all these technologies are tools for you to use, to tinker and play around with, to realize your ideas into tangible objects, and to solve problems, and most of all, to express your creativity. So, why is learning by making so important? There are actually many reasons. Important to a greater or lesser extent. I will go to them quite quickly here. First of all, it's natural. People want to make things, to solve problems, and to change their environment. And research shows that if you make something yourself, you tend to be more proud of it, and you tend to take better care of it. It's called the IKEA effect, and it's scientifically proven. But making also helps children understand the world. Children attending our programs start explaining their parents how things are being made. It makes us question and understand things. Making also helps you to add something to your environment, to understand that everything around you, or almost everything, has been made, and that there are decisions and design choices behind it, and that you can make something and contribute to the world yourself as well. And I think that's very powerful and empowering. And of course, you can learn a lot from it. A lot of new things and new skills. For instance, technical skills, social skills, and creative skills. In Do It, we apply maker education with a focus on developing entrepreneurial competences. This is a sort of container concept, so based on the EU Entrecom model, we determined and specified the different competences that we found most useful and suitable for the context of the project. And these are, amongst others, creativity, self-efficacy, teamwork, motivation and perseverance. There's a FabLearn fellow, Erin Riley, and she made a great list of things that children can learn by digital fabrication, based on her own experience as a teacher. The publication Meaningful Making is a great resource. Check it out. So you may ask, what's new? We have a very rich history of making in education. And yes, that is true. Maker education stands on the shoulders of giants and builds upon learning philosophies of for instance, John Dewey and Seymour Papert. And it has a strong grounding in constructionism. Constructionism stated that learning cannot be delivered to the learner, but it occurs when a new experience makes connections to existing knowledge. And the best way to make that happen is to construct shareable things outside of your head. So, what is new then? I don't know about the situation in your country, but in the Netherlands, in both society and education, we are more and more cognitively addressed. So perhaps we used to make a lot, but in fact we are more and more consumers. And what is new is that computers and affordable technologies become more and more accessible. Microcontrollers, sensor technologies, biotechnologies, etc. And those technical possibilities extend not only what you can make at home or at school, but also extend what you can learn from it. Technologies make projects more interesting and reevaluate handwork. In the Do It programs, children learned to use the following technologies: coding, digital fabrication, sensors, design, but also traditional crafts. So, now is the time to actually start using these new technologies and to rethink our education. It's not a radical change in my opinion, but a shift, a main shift from focus from left to right, from knowledge transfer to knowledge construction, and from a focus on testing to a more portfolio assessment. More focus on the process, more open-ended learning, and more doing and making. And using more physical materials and objects in learning processes. I think it's a bit like an oil tanker. If you shift the course of the ship only 5 degrees, you will end up at a completely different point on the horizon. To facilitate this type of learning, there is a crucial and changing role of the teacher. The role of the teacher or the facilitator is to actually create the conditions for invention, rather than to provide ready-made knowledge. But if our children should learn all these new skills, my strong opinion is that we should ourselves and offer our teachers the opportunity to learn new things in a new way as well. So it's very important that facilitators and teachers of this type of learning get the opportunity, the time and space to acquire this new role. I will dive into the topic of the changing role of the teacher training, and some tips for facilitation in another session. So, thanks a lot for your attention. I hope it was fruitful, and see you next time.